in his height in the 1980s, was considered the grading living exemplar of landscape painting. It was curated into so many shows as like the great living example of the landscape tradition. He goes to the United States in the 80s, and he lectures widely at Harvard and at Yale, and University of Washington, University of Michigan, I think even at Stanford. And he has a chance to see the art of the rest of the world, contemporary art. And he comes back, and he can no longer paint. He felt that painting a traditional landscape was no longer meaningful to him. And when asked why, he said, "I'd seen too much. I'd seen too much art that was happening around the world. And I felt that painting a landscape entirely within the Chinese tradition was no longer meaningful. At least for him, it was no longer meaningful. So he stopped painting. And instead, he started traveling. He lives in Chengdu, so he's very close to Tibet. So every month he would get into his truck or to his car and start driving it into the Himalayan mountains. At first it's very simple. He says, I need to invent a new kind of landscape painting. Chinese have never painted the Himalayas. So if I go to the Himalayas, maybe I will get an inspiration how to paint a new kind of landscape. So he goes and he drives off into the mountains, takes his camera, takes photographs. This is what he sees. This is what he experiences. And this is where he's staying. He's actually staying in Tibetan Buddhist monasteries. And people ask him, they said, are you Buddhist? And he won't clearly say if he's Buddhist or not. And he'll say, no, I'm not Buddhist. So, well, why do you stay at the Tibetan temples, the monasteries? He says, it's the cheapest place to stay in the Himalayas. So he's there, and he describes how in the morning he wakes up at 3 or 4 a.m. It's completely pitch black at that point. And he listens, and he hears the monks shuffling into the prayer hall. Okay, and then a few minutes later he hears Ame Padme Om, Ame Padme Om, Ame Padme, this kind of drone chanting. And it goes on, and it goes on, and it goes on. And he realizes that the state of mind that he achieves while he's in the mountains is the subject of his painting. The actual scenery is not the subject of his painting. And in fact, landscape painting for a long time has not been about the scenery. It's really been about painting the mind of the artist. And so he said, instead of painting a landscape, a scene, I'll paint a line. And that line will record my state of consciousness at that moment. And as that line is drawn out in time, it will record my state of consciousness as it changes through time. And then, basically, if I take a line and I turn it into a grid, then I've achieved what a painting is, which is a two-dimensional art form. A line is a one-dimensional, a grid is two-dimensional. So doing a grid is simply taking a line and fitting it to the conventions of a painting. So he paints grids. And grids. And massive grids. This is five panels. This is about 5 months of work painting the same line for 5 months. Here's some detail from some of the grids. Some of the grids are lines, some of the grids are blocks. Here's some grids installed as a meditation room, which some of his collectors do, especially in Taiwan. You may notice there's a strange sort of shadow in this work. Behind the grid, which you can see is very fine lines, there's some larger lines behind, some larger gestural lines. These are kuang cao, cao shu lines. Okay. So he's combining calligraphy and he's combining grids. Right? So he is showing us the relationship between the calligraphic line and this grid line. This grid line is what? It's the calligraphic line, it's an index of the scene, but again, no language. So his friends all think he's insane, that he's gone crazy. Okay, and to this day, collectors still clamor for his traditional paintings. And his traditional collectors look at his new paintings and they think he's crazy. But these new paintings are in fact still Chinese paintings. They are an abstraction. But not abstraction as in Qiuxiang. They're an abstraction in terms of they're a simplification, they're a reduction. So this idea in calligraphy with Li Huasheng turns into this idea as landscape painting. Okay. The brush line is articulating his state of consciousness in resonance with the landscape. No need for an image anymore. This is sufficient. So you can begin to see, based on this model that we had of latter Chinese painting, latter landscape painting, this is a simplification. The result looks strikingly like maybe Agnes Martin, but it's not. It's something completely different. Here's another artist, Bing Yi, a woman artist. It's actually also another approach to landscape. Her concept is that ink is dark light. It functions like light, but it's dark. It's not light, light. Okay, so what does she mean by that? So what is light? Light allows us to see. And we see things because light that has interacted with something in the world and has been changed by something in the world bounces off that object and enters our eye. Now, how that light interacts with that object depends upon what conditions what we see, changes what we see. An example is this lovely lady here has a turquoise jacket. So what that means is light is bouncing off that jacket, certain wavelengths are absorbed, okay, and the green and the blue wavelengths are reflected. Because of that, that enters my eye and I see turquoise. So it's only because her jacket is interacting with light in a certain way that I see her in the way that I do. Okay? So dark light is made of carbon. That's ink. Soot. Soot interacts very strongly with light. It is almost a perfect absorber of light. So that's why it appears black. When light hits it, it absorbs it. Very little is reflective. That appears to us as black. Then we have water. It's another substance of ink, but it's also a substance that is universal, that's everywhere in nature. Okay? Our bodies are made of water. We talked about this before in the first panel in the morning. Our weather is controlled by water. Right? Life is not possible without water. Water is absolutely essential. Water, however, interacts very weakly with light. If I were to hold a glass of water up here, you could see that there was water, but you couldn't actually see what was happening in the water. It's largely transparent. You add ink to water, and all of a sudden the movement of the water becomes visible. Why is that? The reason why is because the water moves the soot. The soot interacts very strongly with light. And so as a result, you can actually see the movement of the water. This dark light has made something normally close to invisible, visible. So it functions like light, but in a way that's very different, making things that light interacts loosely with something that interacts strongly with light. Now, what's the role of paper? Now, if I were to take this glass of water and look at it, say, 5 minutes later, you wouldn't see this movement at all. It would be pale gray, be dilute, because the ink diffuses and it diffuses equally throughout the water, and all of a sudden, everything in the water is interacting equally with light. It'll be a pale gray, but you won't see any movement. Paper, however, absorbs water and it absorbs the ink if it's in the water. So that if I were to dip a sheet of paper into that glass of water and pull it out, I would get a record of the movement of the ink in the water. So this is the function of the paper. Function of the paper, actually, by interacting with the ink and the water, takes a time slice, takes a moment in time of the movement of the water itself, as reflected and revealed by the strong interactions of the ink with light. This is a lot like photography. Okay? The way photography captures a condition of light in a moment of time. So when you think about the image that she's able to capture during this process, it's fascinating. These are images of water and how it moves. And it looks a lot like the natural world. This looks like some kind of human cell tissue. And it makes sense. Human cells are filled with water. What does this look like? This looks like fire. Or this looks like clouds. Again, both things that are fluid in their movement. And this, again, this almost looks like photography. In the sciences, we call this the intensive versus the extensive. What we see most of the time that's stable is extensive. What we miss most of the time, which is fluidic and moving and constantly changing, is what we call the intensive, something as it's forming. The intensive, when it is in the process of moving and changing, okay, ultimately, oftentimes arrives at a stable, extensive form. Okay, and what we tend to do is we tend to see the world as extensive, static, visible form, as an object with an essence and belonging to a category. If you look at the world intensively, it's fluid, it's oftentimes invisible, it's constantly forming. It is in process, it is a process. It does assume pattern, okay, and it's not categorical, but it's continuous, it's connected. So the weather is not well described by extensive description, it's very well described by intensive description. So how do we use dark ink? Well, one of the things we can do is we can actually record the weather. So Bingyi goes out into the landscape. This is Sanqing Mountains in 2013. She commissions huge, huge sheets, reams of paper, goes out into the mountainside, contacts the local government, gets them to shut down the mountain for her, and she papers the mountainside. And then she applies the ink. And then she adds water, some water, but actually a lot of the water that's applied is the water of the weather system. So she'll spend months studying the weather system of her location. She likes to go out in the summer when the rains are there. And then the mountain, the weather system will rain on the paintings. The wind will dry the paintings. The wind will whip up the paper and change the topology. And basically after weeks, the work is done on the left. And then unrolled, sort of flattened on the right. And then mounted. This is a record of the topology and the weather of a landscape in China. These are often sacred mountain sites. And then when installed, become an immersive installation. This also is a kind of landscape painting. Only instead of the traditional landscape in which you have an artist using their brush and their resonance with the landscape to produce an image that then allows us to be in resonance with the mind of the artist and the landscape, Bingyi simplifies it. In fact, when you look at it, you don't even know where the artist is. There's no brushwork to look at. And there's no, the image is not an image that comes from the mind of the artist. The image is actually something that comes directly from the landscape. It's as if the land and the mountain and the weather has painted this painting using dark light. And that when you see the product of that painting, or the product of that natural world, you're seeing an image that was created by nature. There is no artist. It's a different notion of a landscape. It's a radical reduction, simplification of how we think about landscape. So here's another landscape, Fan Quan. You can probably tell from this, this is an early landscape, not a later landscape. This, what about this? So this is a work of another artist named Deng Chongbing. One of the early abstract ink painters from Shanghai in the 1980s, moved to the US in 1988, got his master's, his MFA at the San Francisco Art Institute in conceptual performance, video, and installation. So not ink painting. He returns to painting, and this is an image that he created. Actually, it's an image that he created in thinking about Xiehe. What do you see when you look at this? So just shout something out. What is it that you see?
A spine.
Wonderful. What else?
A tree.
A tree. So you see the branches, right? The trunk, maybe the spine, or the trees, the branches, the branching part. What else?
Waves.
A what?
Waves.
Waves.
Yeah.
Ah, so there's some kind of fluid wave-like motion going on here.
Rivers.
Ah, imagine flying in a plane and looking at a landscape from above and seeing a river basin, okay? What else? Pardon?
Map.
Exactly. So again, topology from above. Okay. So when asked, he says, you know, oh, were you painting a tree? Oh, were you painting this? Were you painting that? He says, I'm painting none of those things. And yet, these are the things that we see. Okay. So how did this image arise? This image arose because Chongbin, in addition to paper and ink, uses white acrylic. Okay, white acrylic is also water soluble. Okay, but unlike ink, is white, so it's kind of like a white ink. Now, what happens is when white ink and black ink come together and are both using paper as the absorbent ground, what you see is not ink being absorbed into paper, which is the way most Chinese painting is constructed, but what you see is you see white acrylic or white ink and black ink interacting. Two substances with different qualities, different behaviors interacting, now producing these natural forms. Strangely, these natural forms that you see everywhere in nature. So what's going on? So remember I mentioned that there is this world of condensed matter physics, etc., 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 that flows, produce patterns, and that these patterns of change, intensive change, produce stable forms, extensive forms. Well, that's how the natural world works. And in fact, these branching forms are what nature produces on its own. They're called fractals, discovered by a French mathematician, but actually, how could he have discovered it? It's everywhere in nature. Nature uses these geometric forms all the time. So fluidic systems, materials, when they interact through a process of flow, end up producing these stable forms, these branching forms. And that's why they recur everywhere throughout nature. What's happening in his studio is the white acrylic and the black ink are just interacting in exactly the same way materials interact in the rest of the world and are producing the forms that they produce everywhere else in the natural world, only in his studio, on his paper, and if you collect the work in your home. So, these are other images that he produces in his works. Again, we could keep playing this all day long. What kind of natural images that you see? He's not using a brush. He's not painting any of these things. The materials themselves are assembling themselves into these forms. Ink is this, because it makes fluidic movement visible with the introduction of acrylic, now begins to mimic and resemble, okay, to simulate, or actually to enact what happens in the natural world, produces these natural forms on their own. It's geometry, you can call it nature's geometry, fractals. If we have more time, I'd show you a video, that's fine. The last thing I want to talk about is Zheng Chongbin. Okay, so if we were to think about what he's doing, he's reduced it one step further. Okay, so that what you see in his paintings is not a representation of nature, like it's not a picture of nature, it is nature itself. It's nature acting on its own, producing its own image, producing its own form. So the painting, in a way, is not a representation, it is primary, first order presentation. It's nature presenting itself to you. So again, where is the artist in this? Where is the brush in this? There's not even, in a way, an artwork in this. Looking at one of his works is like walking out into the natural world and looking at a tree. The emphasis here is the natural world. So these kinds of paintings or these kinds of works are really the natural world presenting itself to you. Not so focused on you, the viewer. But he has a practice in which he's very, very concerned with perception. It's a light and space installation practice. Now, he's still an ink artist, but he's working with concepts which bring him into installation. So this is a mock-up of a space that he wanted to create. Okay? He was motivated by this notion of how we perceive space. In the West, we have this idea that we perceive things through point perspective. You know, you look at a Renaissance painting and you're standing in front of it and it looks like it's a three-dimensional space extending behind the wall. It's this kind of perceptual magic that's performed. And indeed, if you're in an architected space, that's oftentimes the way we can see space. When you walk into a rectilinear room, you can almost instantly judge the dimensions, the height, the volume of the space, because we're really, really good. We spend a lot of time in architected spaces, rectilinear spaces. So he wants to address this question. Now, what's interesting is in Chinese art, we don't use point perspective. We have a different way of thinking about space. This is another Song landscape, somewhere between the northern and the southern Song. So there's a definite sense of space here, but it's not using point perspective. It's using what we call sai yuan, or three distances. This is a different way of constructing space. So ping yuan is when you are from above looking at space, a flat surface that's below you. And what happens is your eye determines space by traveling along that surface. So you can see if you follow the red arrows, this is the horizontal surface, and as your eye travels over the horizontal surface, you perceive depth. Okay? This is shen yuan. This is deep distance. In shen yuan, what you're doing is if there's a mountain form in front of you or in the composition, if your eye travels across the surface into depth, the surface of the mountain, the vertical surface of the mountain into depth, that's called shen yuan. Your eye is following the surface of forms, okay, that are vertical. So it's like following the right and the left wall here. When I see depth by following the walls, my eye following the walls, that's called shen yuan. So in this landscape, these are how your eye moves along the vertical surfaces of the mountains, okay, to understand that. This is called gao yuan. Gao yuan is when your eye moves vertically from low to high, and by moving vertically, you get increasingly deeper into the composition. It's gao yuan. So ping yuan, shen yuan, gao yuan, it's also the same thing as yuan. Okay, is how to perceive space. What they're describing is three different ways in which your eye moves. Three different forms of movement, a perceptual movement that produces the space. Okay? So what's key is that space is not constructed by sitting in a single spot and perceiving the totality of space. Space is constructed through movement in that space, through that space. That's how space is constructed in a Chinese landscape. So let's get back to this work. You can begin to see that what he's interested in is actually moving your eye. And in this case, you can look at below, this is ping yuan, moving into the composition. Then basically you move up the surface of the wall, that's gao yuan. Now what's interesting is he's constructed the space and the slanting of the walls so that you feel a natural movement, a return back on the ceiling. So for him, the idea of sun yuan is not just going yuan, it's actually jing, it's coming out, it's coming back out at you. Right? And if you look at the way your eye moves horizontally, right and left, you have shen yuan going in, and then shen yuan actually works horizontally across the surface. This movement of the eye, he structures that wall so that you move laterally. And then you come back out. And then you can go back in across and then come back out. So this is his way of thinking about how to animate space. It's a structure, it's a space that requires construction. And you can see the artist here gradually adjusting the angle of the walls to achieve this kind of circulation, this kind of movement. We made the first wall out of steel. And then the artist brings his materials and mounts them. The floor is reflective, so that you can actually see the reflection, you can judge distance and space. And what you'll find that's really interesting is when you enter this space, the normal way in which you perceive rectilinear space, because there are no right angles and there are no parallel surfaces, all the surfaces are skewed but at different angles, so there are no parallel surfaces, you can't use your algorithms, your point perspective algorithms, to judge space. And so what happens is when people enter this space, they circulate. They walk the space, they hug the walls, they circulate in order to understand the space, to explore the space. So 9 out of 10 people who walk into these spaces have this joyous, open experience. About 1 out of 10 people have an anxiety attack and run out. So I'm just gonna play here. An idea of how we built this thing. This was actually a version that we built for the Shanghai Biennale. So what is he doing here? He's basically creating an experience. So as opposed to the landscape on the left in which you're peering at an image, okay, what he's done is he's created an environment that simulates actually being in the natural world, where there's no rectilinearity, where there's no way you can use point perspective as the algorithm for figuring out depth in space. Of course it is indoors, it's not outdoors, and that's the uncanny thing about it. It's not like he puts you out into the natural world. He's putting you in an interior space, but the way in which you navigate it is very much the way in which we navigate the natural world. So again, it's very much like a confrontation in the real world. It's again, this very direct experience. Where is the work of art? It's an experience, okay? Only this time, the emphasis is you and your perception. Okay, so this is just a few examples of how contemporary ink artists are using a way of thinking about the world, the brush as an index of the mind of the artist, brush arts as a form of cultivation, personal, spiritual, moral cultivation, brush arts as a way of bringing oneself in resonance with the natural world. Okay, all of these things together, but now in a radically reduced form. Now you say, I lose so much when we I like the Huang Bing Hong. I want the Huang Bing Hong back, okay? I don't like this new stuff. But sit with it for a while. There's an advantage to doing it in this way. One of which is, have you noticed how clearly each artist is articulating some deep insight about the Chinese brush arts? Wang Dongbing, performance, that's so clear, okay? Zhang Chongbing, the relationship between the viewer and your resonance with the natural world. Li Huasheng, the whole idea of the brush line capturing not just the heart of the artist, but the heart, the artist's mind in resonance with the natural world. So clear what they're doing. So clear, in fact, that you don't need to know anything about the history of Chinese ink art, or the Chinese language, or Chinese philosophy, to actually understand their art. They have found a way to articulate these fundamental principles in a way that the rest of the world can understand. You don't need to be Chinese to understand the language they created, okay? But what they are articulating is distinctively, culturally, historically Chinese. So that's the power of an abstraction, a strategy of abstraction, of radical simplification and reduction. It allows you to explain one thing very clearly, but it also allows you to reach a much broader audience in doing so. So that's all I have for you today. And I know I'm over my time, but I'm happy to stay and answer questions if you have questions.